It all started back in 96 at Walt Disney World. The IRL is about to have its 100th race, and what a ride it's been.
At the line, oh, he's got it! Kent Nevis takes the win.
Look at this. What a
time winner. Freddie Green's Tony Kanaan is the current king of the jungle as he chases his first championship. Behind Kanaan sits 10 hungry drivers who are still alive in the drive. Time is running out, and Nazareth Speedway stands as the next hurdle for these gladiators. At the checker, who will be in sight of Tony Kanaan and the ultimate prize in the IndyCar Series, the Silver Cup? Pennsylvania, and we welcome you to our Firestone pre-race show. This is round 13 of the IRL IndyCar Series and the 100th event in the league's history. Today, it's the Firestone Indy 225. And the revitalization of this track was done by Roger Penske in 1987. His team scored their 100th victory here, and today his cars are on the front row, Todd.
You're exactly right, Paul Page. I'm here with Roger Penske, owner of Marlboro Team Penske. And Roger, this has got to be somewhat of a bittersweet day for you.
Well, you can say that. I mean, coming here when they had Groundhogs here, we landed here with Rick Mears and Danny Sullivan many years ago, and to see this racetrack go today, it's, you know, it's very disappointing. But, you know, time marches on, and we have to look to the future. But the good news was this morning when I woke up and saw these two cars on the front row, I said, this might be a great day for us.
Well, let's talk about that. Your two drivers, Elio Castroneves, Sam Hornish Jr., on the pole. A nice way, an ironic way to send this place out.
Well, we haven't had them side by side yet this year, so this has been terrific. And I think if they behave at the beginning of the race, and we might have a good chance. But, you know, with Kanaan and the rest of the cars behind us, it's tremendous competition. And this type of track is strategy. And what are you going to do on the yellows? Good pit stops and, of course, great driving. And I think that if we can put all that together, we should have a great success.
All right. We wish you the best of luck today, and thank you for your contribution.
Well, thank you.
All right, Paul Page, back up to you.
Hey, thanks, Todd. You know, Nazareth is the hometown of the Andretti family, and it was, in fact, on this very track that Mario Andretti and his twin brother Aldo first began their racing career in the United States. Configuration is the same, except now it's paved.
And, Paul, it's one of the toughest one-mile racetracks on the circuit. You remember last week at Pikes Peak, Buddy Rice ended up spinning on the very first lap on cold tires. A lot of drivers here are really concerned about turn one. It's a funnel-type turn. Everybody has to get through there very safely. On their mind also, pit strategy and fuel mileage, but they got to get to the end for championship points, Jack.
Well, Scott, that's the nature of short track racing. 2 weeks in a row, we've been on a short track. But for Buddy Rice, finds himself mired midfield like he was a week ago, but he can take some solace in the fact that a year ago, Tony Kanaan, leading in the points chase, comes into Nazareth, and this collision with Thomas Scheckter in a target car started a slide that eventually gave Scott Dixon the championship and cost Tony Kanaan the championship. Kanaan's been very quiet all week here. He's not as ebullient. He's not as joyous. He's not laughing as much. I think he's feeling the pressure. If you're Tony Kanaan today, maybe you settle for third or fourth like you did at Pikes Peak and just escape with the points lead.
Well, and last week, Buddy Rice's crash handed another 18 points to TK's advantage. It let Weldon close up a bit, and Dario moved around Hornish for fifth. And Jerry, TK has been pretty solid so far.
Paul, it has been, and last week Tony Kanaan told us he is living a dream, four races away from an IndyCar title. And Tony, but it was this place in this race last year that derailed that dream. How do you play it here today?
We're just going to race. I mean, it's another race. It's just another day, so we're not thinking about anything besides finishing this race. And championship is still a long ways. We did got hit here last year, so we make sure that doesn't happen.
You've been in somewhat of a reflective mode here all week long. How much do you let yourself think about this championship, about realizing that dream when you're alone?
I try not to think about it. Obviously, people keep asking you all the time, but I'm pretty cool. I'm relaxed, and you know, if it's meant to be, it's gonna be meant to be. I know what I can do. I know what the 7-Eleven team can do. So we're just gonna go out there and have fun.
Hey, good luck to you today. Be safe.
Thank you,
Paul. It's what this series is all about: men with passion and a dream.
But Jerry, there is Tony George, the founder of the IRL. He must be pleased with this, the 100 race and the progress of the league. We'll be celebrating throughout the telecast this 100 by looking back at the history. In January of 96, Walt Disney World played host to the first ever IRL IndyCar race. Buzz Calkins held off USAC champion Tony Stewart for the historic win. The following year, Stewart was crowned the IRL champion. Some tank killers, Air Force A-10 Warthogs from the 103rd Fighter Squadron, and the flyby just before the start of the race here as the ceremonies continue. We're at Nazareth, Pennsylvania. The IRL's 100th race is now just minutes away. Yesterday's qualifying had some surprises and great news for Toyota. Here is the front of the field in the first half of our Firestone starting grid.
Helio Castroneves, car number 3. Sam Hornish Jr., car number 6. Tony Kanaan, car number 11.
Dario Franchitti, car number 27.
Darren Manning, car number 10.
Adrian Fernandez, car number 5.
Brian Herta, number 7.
Dan Weldon, car number 26.
Vitor Meira, car number 17.
Buddy Reich, car number 15.
Thomas Schechter, car number 4.
Scott Dixon, car number 1.
Dixon won his first race here. Of the four AGR drivers, though, only Brian Herta has yet to win. But he drives the team's R&D car, so really a win isn't expected for the likable lifelong racer.
And yet Brian Herta, many people feel, is the linchpin to the success of Andretti Green Racing. And for Brian Herta, driving in the IRL was the culmination of a lifelong dream.
This is it. This is my field of dreams.
This is where I started my racing career. It's not much to look at now, but back in the day when I was 12, I convinced my dad to buy my first racing cart, and we had a little dirt oval out here, a fifth of a mile, and it's where I learned to race.
He bought a go-kart for about $50 he paid for. It was a used go-kart. It was actually a piece of junk. Always wanted to race since he was 5 or 6 years old. As we moved around the country from Michigan to Connecticut, back to Michigan, and out here to California, I always had the same wallpaper in his room. It was all race cars.
We wallpapered that room, everything, the whole room. Closet doors, everything was that wallpaper. And I used to fall asleep every night dreaming about being a race car driver.
Those dreams became a reality when Brian got his first shot in a Skip Barber car. And from there, he progressed to Indy Lights, proving to everyone that he had the talent, but most importantly, the determination to become a champion. Then in 1994, he got a call that would change his life.
A.J. Foyt called me up and said, "Son, I've been told I should think about hiring you to drive for me at Indy 500. And literally, I think I hung up on him the first time he called. I did not believe it was, I'm like, this is not A.J. Foyt. A.J. Foyt is not calling me to ask me to drive for him.
Yeah, despite Brian Herta's test role in the team, it will in fact be Dario Franchitti at the wheel when the IRL begins testing on road courses this week. That's part of the next step envisioned for the IRL by Tony George. Jerry Punch.
And Paul, I'm with the president and CEO of the Indy Racing League. And Tony, what a landmark day for the league and for open wheel racing in general here. And earlier today, your vision was recognized by the fine folks at Firestone with a very special presentation.
Well, it was an honor when they asked me to serve as Grand Marshal for this, the 100th event in the IndyCar Series. And that means a lot to me. It's really an honor to represent all of the participants and the officials and the fans who supported the Indy Racing League from the beginning. And if it weren't for Firestone, I don't know where we would be. They've been a great sponsor, started off as a supplier relationship, and it's grown into one that is so much more. The partnership that we have and enjoy today with Firestone is second to none in the industry. They sponsor races. They provide marketing support in market. They just do so much. They provide us a safe race tire, which is the most important thing. And we've done a lot of good things together to grow our relationship. And I couldn't ask for a better partner than Firestone.
Tony, the series has come so far, so fast. Of all you've accomplished here in the first 9 years, what are you most proud of?
Well, I think, again, it's a tribute to the people that work and support and compete in the Indy Racing League and all the fans that support it. It's just the on-track competition. It's, in my opinion, the best today in racing on four wheels or two. It all started back in Walt Disney World Speedway in 1996, and that was a very memorable event, a historic event that took place. I think back to those days now and see where we've come, and it's been a rocky road, but a road well worth traveling. I'd do it again, and I look forward to the next 100.
Hey, Tony, congratulations on a great vision. Successful Indy Racing League 100th race here today.
Don't forget on ABC primetime tonight, the Little League World Series championship game, and then, of course, Extreme Makeover Home Edition and the practice. At this track in 2002, the race was won by Scott Sharp. Sharp is the senior man in the IRL field today, and when we come back, we'll spend some time with Sharpie. Enormous crowd on hand here today for round 13 of the IRL IndyCar Series. We left the starting grid at row 6, so here is the rest of the Firestone starting grid.
Townsend Bell, car number 2.
Alex Barron, car number 51.
Mark Taylor, car number 13.
Jacques Lazaire, car 20.
AJ Foyt, fourth, car number 14.
Kosuke Matsuda, car number 55.
Felipe Giafone, car number 24.
Kura Takagi, car number 12.
Scott Sharp, car number 8.
Ed Carpenter, car number 52.
And that's our Firestone starting grid. It'll be a long way on this short track from the last row to the front for Scott Sharp. But if anyone knows how, it's Sharpie. Scott Sharp's life was dominated by race cars. His father, Bob, was a 6-time national champion in the SCCA.
The questions were never asked. Are you going to drive? Or do you think you want to drive? It was just when.
At the age of 8, he began his racing career in go-karts and was a natural, winning 50 times in 75 starts. Like his dad, he was a multi-time champ in the SCCA, and in 96, he became the IRL Series inaugural co-champion. Since 98, his success has been with the Tom Kelly Racing Team.
Great job, Scotty!
I've got an incredible passion for the sport, and I literally, eat, sleep, walk, drink the sport.
Scott's passion is also shared by his son, Jackson.
If you stay on the bottom, they can't pass you. It's a longer way around on the outside.
Sharp maintains the slide advantage.
No bumping, remember? It's fun when your son has the passion you have.
Winner! Yay!
Scott Sharp drives and gets the advantage and comes down and wins it.
Sharp's been the leader on mile wins. Franchitti's been looking so strong this year. Remember last week on his way to victory, Dario Franchitti had trouble on one of his pit stops. As they came in, the team couldn't pull the vent, but then they recovered quickly. And then yesterday, Dario headed into the pits in the wrong lane, and he got Scott Dixon. Well, there was no question here about whose fault that was.
Absolutely my fault. I was coming through the pit lane here and I came in a bit hot and I locked the tires up, so I went down inside Scott to avoid hitting him. Then I look up just in time to see that the target guys are pitted first and second in the pit lane, so I collected him, spun him around. Luckily none of the target guys were hurt, but again, absolutely my fault, and I went down there and apologized to them. And it's dangerous enough in pit lane, as we've seen this year, without me doing stupid stuff like that.
Yeah, but at least Dario is man enough to admit it and go down and apologize for the transgression. Will this be another victory today? Franchitti, the short track master of this year. We do thank you all for joining us for the Firestone pre-race show. And we move closer in front of this giant crowd to the start of the 100th event in the history of the Indy Racing League. Stay with us. Sunshine burns down on Nazareth Speedway as the IRL is ready for its 100th event. And it'll be here on ABC Sports. The crowd, it's a magnificent crowd here today. And now it's time for those most famous words.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for those most famous words in racing. Please welcome back President and CEO of the Indy Racing League, Tony George.
Nazareth Speedway race fans, welcome to the 100th IndyCar event, the Firestone Indy 225. On behalf of all of the participants of the Indy Racing League, it's my pleasure to give the command today. Gentlemen, start your engines.
Oh, yeah, there you go. That's the way to get it started.
Well, I think that's the first time that Tony George has ever uttered the command that his grandfather made famous, Anton Hulman.
And there was a lot of his grandfather in that as well. We're going to review the starting grid for you up there at the top of the screen as the field all gets ready to roll out. The cars, all engines indicating started and ready to go, lined up, ready for the final signal from the IRL to send them on their way. This is round 13 of 16. 225 times around this 1 mile track, and the pit window opens about lap 70.
But the key factor in the race analysis has got to be the average and estimated gas mileage. Under green flag laps, you can get as much as 2.6 miles per gallon. But look what's happened with the technology in the IRL. Under caution, you can get almost 9 miles or 8 miles to the gallon. I can't get that in my passenger car.
We call it a mile track. It's not really that, it's a little shorter.
Paul, it's actually 9.34 is what they have actually measured at this racetrack, and it's a very, very tough race for all these guys to passionately drive.
Field rolls away nice and easy. And as they clear, here's the track itself, Scott.
Very odd shape. You can see only three turns here, turns one, two, and three, all different to each other, making it very difficult for drivers and engineers to set up for this racetrack. Only 6 degree banking maximum in any of these turns, unlike the high bank turns where you get some assistance from the banking to help the car get through the turns. Drivers have a very difficult, difficult time to be able to get through these turns, especially two abreast. As we ride along with Thomas Schechter right now, we're coming along the front stretch out of three, going across the start line. He'll upshift to top gear, get through this kink, which is very difficult for the start. Up here through two, it's like a roller coaster up to the top of the hill right here, feathering the throttle, and then the run down the hill from two down towards three, the best spot for cars to pass, going on the inside of three here. Down one gear and back up and pass the start line again. 9.34 miles, guys, 20 seconds.
Plenty of onboard cameras for you starting back in the field, Scott Sharp. And we'll bring you up through the field. And of course, one is on board with TK Tony Kanaan. All right, guys. Predictions, Jack.
Well, I'm going to go to the front row and not to the pole sitter, Paul. I'm going to say that Sam Hornish Jr. is going to be victorious. He likes the short tracks. He likes the high side of racetracks. He's not afraid to take chances, and that's what you've got to do to win here, Scott.
Guys, I'm going to go with the team that's on the roll right now. Adrian Fernandez, first and second, the last two races. I got to pick him today.
I'm going to go with Elio Castroneves because I like him. Jerry?
Michael Andretti, last race at your home track. Going to be a little sad for you.
Yeah, it's real sad, but you know, hopefully one of these four guys can bring it home for us and make it a happy day anyway.
The home track for the Andretti's, a lot of history here. What a special day here at Nazareth, Pennsylvania, guys.
And Michael won the first one for the open wheel series here when it first came back in 87. That's pretty nice alignment over on the backside.
Quick update, it's 123 degrees on the racetrack. Ambient temperature is pretty hot too today. Now it's gonna get hot in the racetrack.
Green flag, green flag, green flag.
And so the 100th race is underway as Castroneves moves quickly to the lead. Hornish Jr. drops in behind him and the rest of the field comes through turn one with no problems. Now onto the back stretch. On board Tony Kanaan as he tries to catch Hornish just ahead. Well, take a look at that. Schechter with Manning just coming around the outside. Manning has been quick here. That Toyota's working for him.
And Thomas Schechter's going to try and thread the needle right there through the wall. And Manning, Thomas Schechter was fastest, guys, in warm-up yesterday. His car looked really good through traffic.
Fernandez just ahead of Schechter, the number five, that red and green car. Schechter using a little higher line. And Scott, it seems to work for him out there.
Well, the Panther cars have always worked here on the high side. Remember Sam Hornish last year? That's what's going to take to win this race.
The South African, as we continue to ride with him, we go to the front of the field. Castro Neves, Hornish Jr., and Toyota, 1 and 2. Toyota engineers have been in a bit of a funk this year. They've been trying to catch up, but they, I think, were actually astonished at how powerfully Honda came back for the start of this season.
Paul, on short tracks, it's all about timing, especially if you're Thomas Schechter. This was the start of the race, came up to speed. Now it's critical. He wants to try and get as many cars as he can. He dispatches Buddy Rice. He takes care of Vitor Mira. He goes by Brian Herta. That's three cars on the track that they say you're not supposed to be able to pass. So let's make it four cars. Go by Dan Weldon as well.
And Jack, there might be something to that right now because Thomas Schechter's a man that does not have a contract for next year. Spoke to John Barnes, the team owner and manager, and he said, you know, we've opened the discussions with him. We don't have anything set right now. So he's a guy that wants to be in that seat next year. They want him there, but you can bet he's certainly driving for a job.
It's got a lot to do with being fearless as well. And one thing you can say about Thomas Schechter, he is indeed that.
Thomas Schechter started 11th, now runs 6th as we show you on the move. Bell, Matsura, Chiafoni, they're also moving. You saw Darren Manning as he made his move, but it's still Castro Neves, the red and white number three car that runs in front. Hard to believe that his favorite restaurant, this international guy, it's right here in Nazareth.
So obviously you guys have never been there and had an awful, right?
Never have, and what would that be?
That's a giant milkshake. The straw sticks straight up in it. It is awful.
Oh, man, give me a towel.
In a positive sense.
So Castro Neves, Hornish, Kanaan, Franchitti, Fernandez, and then Schechter.
Now, we haven't seen the Penske cars run up front very much this year, guys, but Toyota had a manufacturer's test here just a couple of weeks ago. They had the opportunity to run here, and basically what is their home track is Reading, Pennsylvania, is the headquarters for Marlboro Team Penske. Came here, had an excellent test for 2 days, and it's proving right now that really served them well.
Sam Hornish's top movies. That actually is not all that far off of what my list would be.
Well, you remember when he had the soul patch that he wore on his chin? That was a dedication to his favorite movie, Pulp Fiction, and John Travolta.
Already the leaders of the race move around, and at least try to move around some of the back of the field. They've caught the back already. And that's Ed Carpenter that's just ahead of them in the number 52 Red Bull car. But look at what it's done. It's compressed the front.
That's what drivers always worry about here. You can actually get behind somebody and slow yourself up about 1.5 mile an hour. You know, as we're running along here right now, I have to tell you one thing. Drivers are trying to get past traffic as quickly as possible.
We're at Nazareth, Pennsylvania, Nazareth Speedway. The 100th race of the IRL is already 13 laps old. Elio Castro Neves jumped out in front right from his position on the pole. His teammate Sam Hornish Jr. moved in just behind him. He remains there right now. Tony Kanaan, the current points leader, slides into third place. Most of the fighting has come back behind the leader in this field of a 225 lap run, 225 miles. And throughout this day, we will continue to look at some of the history of the 100 races of the Indy Racing League. In 2001, Sam Hornish Jr. won his first IRL IndyCar title at the age of 22, the youngest champion in Major League Open Wheel history. In 02, the familiar colors of Team Penske joined the IRL, competing in the IndyCar series on a full-time basis. I know this is the largest crowd I've seen at Nazareth Speedway, maybe locals, including all the folks out of the Lehigh Valley, trying to convince people that they can fill up this stadium. The IRL IndyCar Series, its 100th race. You ride with Tony Kanaan. He's currently third. He is, though, the points leader in the series. And Elio Castroneves is the leader, followed by Hornish Jr. Let's go down to Jerry Punch.
Guys, we saw Thomas Schechter make a move when the green flag waved. In the first three laps, he gained five spots. And from 11th to 6th, where he's now sitting and riding comfortably, that was by design. Thomas Schechter said, when the green waves, I'm going to light the fires on this Pennzoil machine. And while the tires are good, I'm going to pass as many as I can, because when the track gets a little bit greasy, it's going to be very hard to pass. He made five spots. Now he sits comfortable in 6th and is biding his time.
Yeah, Franchitti is well up the track from that in 5th place, and there is the lead all tightly together. Castroneves has the red camera pod on the top of his car. That second car is Hornish, number 6. He has a white camera pod up on top. And of course, then here comes the rest of the gang: Kanaan, Fernandez, Franchitti, and Schechter. And traffic is their concern and challenge now. This is just a couple of seconds ago as they went around A.J. Foyt the fourth. Whoa, how'd you like to be in the 14 car for that one? Buddy Rice, by the way, second in the points, currently runs 11th. Whoa. As Ed Carpenter comes onto the pit road.
And Ed Carpenter, guys, just the other day had a very hard crash in his primary car, ended up going to his backup car. Just a little tender and sore, and just a little bit apprehensive right now.
Yeah, this track, with its unique design, they actually enter the pits over on the back straightaway and come all the way around until they get to the pit road. Looking for the work they might be doing on this car.
No wing changes, which tells you maybe they just did some tire pressure changes for him. He'll go out and see how he likes that, and they'll continue to adjust the car, try and make it better for him throughout the day.
So Ed Carpenter heads back onto the course. You know, the field here, like I think all of us, are keeping track of the Olympic Games, what's going on, who's doing what, what's the medal count. But of course, the drivers here represent a fairly international group.
Obviously, I watched the United States beat Brazil in the beach volley and soccer, which is, you know, I think you guys doing a great job.
The sprint at them was, those guys are unbelievable. They can run fast. Those guys can run pretty fast.
The sport that I like the most there, it's biking and triathlon.
I think it'd be good to have go-karts, you know, sort of like the that race of champions they have in France with the carts. It'd be fun to have sort of like a shifter cart deal or something.
You got everybody from different countries racing this series anyway, so it's like the Olympics. Every weekend we go race, it seems like we're got a bunch of different countries over here racing with us, and it's great.
Let's get 30 of the best go-karts in America. Let's get all the NASCAR drivers, all the IRL drivers, and whoever else wants to compete, and let's have a fight and see who's best. It is, after all, right, left, stop, go. But yes, it should be an Olympic sport.
Eddie Cheever, that's a pretty cool idea.
Yeah, and there's a direct connection with the Olympics and Team USA with this car. Ted Bidding is a co-owner and the team manager of Mark Taylor's machine. Well, it was his cousin that took the silver in the pole vault. He wears a helmet, Paul. They call him Toby, but his nickname is Crash. Toby Crash Stevenson, silvered for Team USA in the pole vault.
That's pretty neat, too. 33 laps of the 225. We've been clean right from the start. Castroneves, Hornish, Kanaan, 1-2-3, Todd Harris.
Well, just give you a quick update on Ed Carpenter, the 52 Red Bull Cheever racing vehicle. He says he's complaining of a little understeering and he's having grip issues. But when he came in, he rated in and said, don't change anything. They went four tires and fuel and sent him back out. Paul?
The that's interesting. Come in, but don't change anything despite the issues. How do you read that, Scott?
Well, I'll tell you, if the car wasn't working the way I liked it, I'd like to make a couple of changes anyways just to see if we can improve the car. Don't get too many times to stop in the pits and make those changes in the day, Paul.
Casper Nevis, Hornish, going to look back into fifth place. Dario Franchitti, second quick last time around, been running some brilliant laps.
The big question from Dario Franchitti all week long, as we look at the Firestone telemetry aboard Dario's car, was the big question was, well, what about Ashley Judge? She wasn't in victory lane, and you told our Jerry Punch that she was at a yoga retreat. So how did the yoga retreat go while you were busy winning last week?
And the answer was?
You wouldn't answer me.
Oh, yeah. Well, you were the only one that would ask a question like that. So I got asked that question at home, I might say.
Hey, guys, I just talked to Ashley a moment ago, and she said it was the best thing she has ever done. She's at a cabin way up in the upper part of the Northwest, and she sat up there and she relaxed and she visualized Dario Franchitti winning on Sunday and being a major factor these last four races. And sure enough, she says, whenever it was, when it was karma, when it was yoga, it worked. She said, I may go back next week.
And that may be working pretty well. There's Buddy Rice. Currently 11th, and he's been kind of stuck back here. That's Herta in front of him.
Paul, I had a conversation with Buddy today just after the driver's meeting. He says, you know, we know our car is not stout on 1 mile racetracks, but we hope the track will come to us. We hope the car will come to us as we are along with Townsend Bell right now. And I'll tell you, he said, I feel confident. I think as the day wears on, we're actually going to move ourselves forward.
Townsend Bell likes Anthony Edwards. I think his best performance was in Top Gun myself, but then I'm prejudiced toward aircraft carriers.
And that dates you, Paul.
It does, doesn't it?
Yes.
Now you can see he's having some difficulty with the car. Watch his right hand over here. He's going down two gears as he's coming up right in the underneath of Rice. Remember, a lot of disturbed air coming through these turns. Here's turns two. You go up over the top of the hill and you start to roll down the hill. It's almost like a roller coaster. That turn is blind when you go into it. You cannot see what's on the other side. Best place for passing, we talked about turn three right here. He's got to get on the gas, get on early, and hopefully get a run for Buddy Rice through turns one and two to make that move in three.
Back up to the front of the field with now 40 laps complete. We're working 41, and Elio Castroneves is still the leader ahead of his teammate, Sam Hornish Jr. Elio is leading his seventh race of the season, but his last win came here 1 year ago. Will Elio be able to win today? Roger hopes so. Back again, Nazareth Speedway, the IRL's 100 race before a great crowd here today. It is still Casper Nevis, Hornish Jr., and then Tony Kanaan, TK. You ride with him right now. You know, it's not more than 2 hours from here to Williamsport, Pennsylvania, where tonight it's the Little League World Series, and the title is on the line. The U.S. champs, Thousand Oaks, California, will take on Curaçao, Nether Antilles. Both teams undefeated at 5-0. That's tonight on ABC Sports. Thomas Schechter sitting back in the field, and he's had his problems. He's dropped through the field now to 14.
You know, Thomas, they have a head engineer, Andy Brown, who's on medical leave right now, was not at Pikes Peak last week, is not here this week. Had an operation. We wish him the best. Wish he gets back soon. The team says they're not sure when he will return. And this car is still being engineered by David Cripps, a great group over there. But they got probably miss Andy just a little bit.
There's your leader, Elio Castroneves. He comes around Tora Takagi. Looking for a win for Roger Penske. And this, the last race at this track. They're going to start taking the grandstands down here, they say, as early as Monday. Castroneves followed by his teammate, Sam Hornish Jr. Roger pointed out, first time on the front row this season for Marlboro Team Penske. Roger scored with Jill DeFerrin at the wheel, his 100th open wheel victory at this track. Remember 1994? unlikely time to test the car, but they had to do it in secret. That was the pushrod Mercedes that later drove on to victory at the Indianapolis 500, but they didn't want anybody to know that they'd put it together, and it pushed Allanser Jr. into his second win.
And the crew in Allanser Jr. as Thomas Schechter pulls onto pit road. Obviously, the car, guys, was going away, so they pit a little bit early because you could go to about lap 75.
Well, that's taking some care on getting that car out, but of course they need to. So Schechter comes back onto the course. Change of tires there. Those Firestone Firehawks that have served this series so well, Jerry Punch.
Exactly, Paul. They've been a major part of the success story here. In fact, I am with Executive Director of Firestone Motorsports, Al Spire. And Al, you guys have a special way of celebrating this anniversary day.
Well, yes, it's the 100th race for the IRL, but it's also the 100th race for Firestone. We've been in every race since 1996, and in that time, we've supplied over 100,000 Firestone tires to the IRL and logged over 1 million miles on those Firestone Firehawks.
What a great track record, and there's the emblem on the tire, by the way. How does all this success at the racetrack translate to the consumer?
Well, I think for the fans, what's really important to know that some of the ingredients we use in the race tires are the same ingredients we use in the street tires. We have an LL carbon, which is a long linker. It's just a stronger carbon black, part of our Unity technologies. On the racetrack, it helps us resist heat, but for the fans at home, it gives them longer wear and better wet traction, kind of our magical ingredient that makes our Firestone tires the best they can be.
Makes them feel comfortable and safe. Al, congratulations on you guys being a major part of the IRL success story.
Well, thanks. We're glad to be a part of it. This is a big, fast, exciting laboratory. We're glad to use it for everybody's benefit.
Firestone, a wonderful partner here in the Indy Racing League. We are getting set for pit stops down here.
And we got a car against the wall, and it's Mark Taylor. The yellow just comes out, and comes out at a pretty advantageous time for the rest of the field. But Mark Taylor with some pretty serious right side damage.
You can see the right side, as you mentioned, Paul, taken off there. Just a pancake towards the wall. The rear wing is off. A fair amount of damage to that race car. You can see the steering wheel was coming off. That tells the driver is okay. We have a report right now that you might have had some contact with a two car, Townsend Bale, that you're riding along with right now.
Tough break for this team, though, because they're sporting two brand new sponsors today, Serta and Transglobal. First race that the car owner and former driver of this team, Greg Ray, is not in attendance. He flew here, landed, his cell phone cave went off yesterday as he landed at the Lehigh Valley Airport. And a potential sponsor for the rest of this season and for next season said, you got to come back. We want to talk to you more. He's trying to put together a two-car team for the final two races.
Oh, that'd
year.
Be great for Mark Taylor. Ride with Townsend. And Mark Taylor, they're now getting him out of the car. So, yes, it appears he's okay. First indication, as Scott Goodyear suggested, was when he pulls the steering wheel off the column and sets it up. And, of course, when he does that, it disconnects the radio transmit switch, so he can't tell the team he's okay.
And when the crew get to any crash scene, Paul, there's a small little light indicator that's on the side of the car. It's a green and a red light system. And actually, if the red light is on, it means the car has been subject to over 50 G's upon impact. If the green is there, they know it's maybe not that high at it.
We've got two angles. The first from Townsend. See if they got together. Yeah, you bet they did.
Now, right there, you have to say that you have to look at Mark Taylor and say, man, somebody's coming up on the inside of you. Spotter should have told him, but I will give him the benefit of the doubt right now that in turn two, it's very difficult for the spotters to see because of the bridge over there, so he might have got surprised.
Only one angle for you. There is Mark Taylor, and if there would be damage, it would be on the right side of the car, so you can rest assured they're going to spend some time looking at it. Excuse me, that's Townsend Bell. And the pits are now open. So we'll see how it looks and whether or not we can get this first round of pit stops under our belt without any problems. Castro Neves is the leader.
Now the guy that's going to hurt on this a little bit probably is going to be Thomas Schechter. He had to pit underneath the green when the race pace is much higher. he could have made it to this 16-second lap that we're at right now, he could have pit underneath yellow, which is exactly what they're waiting for. But because the car wasn't handling, he had to come in early.
So the whole field peels off, led by Elio Castroneves. Todd Harris?
Well, they're talking to Elio Castroneves. No major problems for him. The only thing he's saying is he needs tire pressure adjustment. So they're going to work on his tire pressure. The three car is in, and the six is right next to him. For Sam Hornets Jr., though, it's going to be a different story. He wants one turn in that front ring, and he wants the tire pressure decreased all the way around.
Jerry Punch.
And points leader Tony Kanaan says, I have a bit of an understeer, but don't change a thing. Kanaan, great pit stop, and he will be among the first. Wow, what a scramble off pit road. Kanaan had the end pit here by being the points leader, and it was very, very close.
Yeah, that was a tight pinch as they came out of the corner. Here comes the field, still we need a good look. There you go, and that's the information we wanted. Tony Kanaan got out ahead of Sam Hornish and behind Elio Castroneves.
The key thing for Tony Kanaan's team is that they can look down pit road, wait to see when the Marlboro cars have done their service, and when the Marlboro cars are released, they can almost do a short fill. They can actually take the fuel nozzle out of Tony Kanaan's car, drop the cars off the jack, and let him sprint to the white line, the timing line that's just a few feet in front of his pits, because he does have the first pit box.
We got to cut this thing. You're only down one lap. We can get that back before the end of this race.
And once he gets over that white line, he ends up turning around and having the front position.
That radio transmission was to Scott Sharp's car. Here is, as they came out of the pits, there is Sharp a lap down. There's Elio, he's the leader. Oh, by about a foot and a half. Not bad. So the team gave to Tony Kanaan what he couldn't earn on the racetrack, and that is the one position. And you wonder why they have trouble in the pits and why pit stops are so critical. Right there is your answer.
Penske is one of the best teams at pit stops. You heard him on the opening say, you know something? It's going to come down to pit strategy and pit timing. He's one of the best.
Tire pressure's clutch.
Michael Andretti's watching his guy. Second place now, still the points leader. Can he get around the leader?
Is a reality today because of Tony George's vision for improving driver safety. Congratulations on 100 great races.
Safety has always been paramount in the IRL, and in 2002, the Safer Barriers made their debut at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. That same year, Sarah Fisher became the first woman to win a pole, doing so at Kentucky Speedway. Tony has spent millions of dollars on safety in the series, and Dr. Sissy right in there helping as well. We're at Nazareth Speedway, the Firestone Indy 225. Don't forget, ABC's Monday Night Football will officially open up its 35th anniversary season. The Super Bowl champion Patriots take on the Indianapolis Colts. Plus a major NFL opening kickoff celebration for the start of the new season. So Tony Kanaan, we understand Jerry Punch may have a problem.
He does. Let's quickly get in with Kim Green if we can. And Kim, we're told you lost the telemetry on the car. How will it impact you the rest of the day?
We're about to go green, but certainly it's hurting. We're using our teammates' telemetry to try and help us out a bit here, but Tony's doing a great job, and he's got a dash that he's working off.
Okay, we'll back away so he can call the green flag. As you mentioned, Scott Goodyear, he has a number he can see on the dash, but even that is a bit intermittent. Getting ready for the green.
And it is green at Nazareth Speedway on the 71st lap. We had 10 laps of caution. Elio, as he should, pulls away. Scott Dixon moves on toward Takagi. Downs and Bell inside of Schechter.
Schechter using that high line again. He was down two laps, but they ended up getting a lap back on that last yellow. So he's got a little driving to do if he's going to get to the front and end up getting his lap back.
Just ahead of the yellow car sector there, that red car, number 20, that's Jacques Lazier.
Townsend Bell, Paul, has had a wild ride thus far, using all the racetrack, even the safety apron, and maybe just a quarter of an inch of the grass as he tried to get around Ed Carpenter in that blue and yellow car.
So after our first caution of the day for 10 laps, that one, Mark Taylor got into the wall. We're back to high-speed action, the first pit stop for most of the field occurring during that. In this, the 100th race for the IRL IndyCar Series. The leader is Elio Castroneves. He has led right from the start, but with the pit stop, and Tony Kanaan was able to get around and into second place ahead of Castroneves' teammate Sam Hornish Jr. So at the front of the field in this 100th run, 75 laps gone, and it's Toyota, Honda Toyota, Castroneves, Kanaan, Hornish. Except for the one incident with the wall involving Taylor, it's been a very, very smooth and very fast race in front of a great crowd here. The last race to be held at Nazareth Speedway, and at the same time, the 100th race of the IRL IndyCar Series. There's your leader. That's a pretty good run downhill there, Scott, isn't it? Really, we never really seem to be able to show it, but you sure see it if you're in the cockpit.
When you're sitting inside the car, Paul, it's almost a little bit like a roller coaster. You certainly get that feeling going down the hill. Then you end up having that great run into turn three where you have that opportunity to hopefully do some passing.
There's fifth place Adrian Fernandez, who has been running laps in the top three speeds. In fact, last time around, he was at 152.6 miles an hour.
We've talked about Adrian Fernandez adapting so quickly to the IRL IndyCar style of competition. He said when he first came here, he wasn't sure he made the right decision in trying to consolidate the team. But he's gone on, he's got a win, he's got some top five finishes, being very consistent. He said, it was a gamble, but it's paid off for my team.
And Jack, John Ward told Adrian Fernandez, if we don't change anything on the car, the veteran engineer said the track will come to us. And he just told Fernandez, the last two laps you ran are the two fastest you have run today. The track is indeed coming our way.
And they've in fact been the fastest fastest lap time of all the cars on the track in the last two. It's better than 152 miles an hour. Here's Dan Weldon. He inched a little bit closer from his third place position in the point standing when Buddy Rice caught the wall a week ago at Pikes Peak. Helping Weldon, also helping his teammate, current points leader Tony Kanaan.
And the man that has been mentoring Dan Weldon in the chase for the championship and the performance of him on the IRL circuit has been the current points leader Tony Kanaan. They're very close, and I find it kind of ironic that two points chasers talk to each other, calm each other down, and motivate each other in a chase for exactly the same title.
There's the guy that the rest of the team is always playing the practical jokes on.
See, he loves shopping. I asked him, how many sets of shoes does he have? Move over, Emel DeMarcos. In his new home, 200 pairs of shoes.
You're kidding me. A man? I'm going to have to start pulling jokes on Weldon myself, if that's what I do.
But you know what his teammates did to him actually in Japan?
Now what?
Took one out of each set, put them in a box, mailed them back to the United States. He ended up having to walk around with two different sets of shoes in Japan.
With those kind of friends. As they run right now, Tony Kanaan has gained 20 points on Rice, and he now has, at this moment, an 88-point lead. Brian Herta, fourth car in the Andretti Green Racing stable, yet to win this year, but as we mentioned at the start of the show, his primary job with Buddy Rice right behind him there in the Pioneer car. Whoa, Buddy tries to get inside, and Herta's not going to allow it. That car for that team is widely known as the test bed for the team, the research and development car. So not really expected to win, though you never know if Tony Kanaan gets a good lead. They may just want to make a little history by putting that car out in front. Wow, all over the place, side by side. God, this is great.
Clear.
That was Kosuke Matsura, the 55 car you saw going backwards there. He got pushed up and wisely got out of it.
Remember, Kosuke had that crash last week at Pikes Peak, and he said, you know, I'm still a little bit sore, shoulders feeling okay, but just a little hesitant right now. And what a tough racetrack to come to here at Nazareth. when your confidence is a little bit down on the 1 mile circuits.
Are you getting thrown around that much in the car, Scott, here?
Not really thrown around, but you have to have confidence to be able to drive the car into the turn. And when you had a crash just last week, it's very difficult. Now, Koski's on the outside. You see him way up here on the top side, and he's in that blue and red car. And what he ends up doing is getting off the gas, getting in the high side, and that's getting where all the rubber is on the racetrack, all the marbles, as they call it, Paul.
When that tightened it up for Buddy Rice and the rest that were right there, you look back from the 7-Eleven car of our points leader, Tony Kanaan. It's Catherine Evans, Kanaan Hornish. We'll be back after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
Welcome back to Nazareth, Pennsylvania. The Firestone Indy 225. Moments ago, Mark Taylor, the 13 car, involved in an incident. Mark, why don't you take us through it? What happened?
It's a tough situation. We got backed up into the leaders by the 52, and we were struggling with the car. The tires were going off, but you're trying to let the leaders go past as easy as possible, and it's just one of those situations that I felt that Townsend dived down the inside of me and didn't give me any room, nowhere to go. It was either... So I tried to give him as much room as I could. We ended up, I think my front wheel hit his side pod and just ended up going in the wall. It's one of those situations. It was a shame because the car felt pretty good at the beginning. It was just we needed to come in for a pit stop.
That was the bad news. The good news is potentially a new sponsor for Greg Ray and the team.
Absolutely. It's looking good for access from, we're looking for a two-car team from Texas onwards. And of course, hopefully for next year, we've got some great sponsorship deals coming up, hopefully.
Wish you the best of luck, and we're glad you're okay.
Thanks.
98 laps complete. Your leader still is Elio Castroneves. Paul Page.
Castroneves still out in front, but Hornish Jr. got around Kanaan and comes back into second place through traffic. Kanaan, you can see, has fallen off just a bit. And remember, that car is not transmitting its telemetry data to the pits, so they're using their other cars to try and figure the data. And a lot of the old-fashioned system. Just look at the dash.
And Paul, that telemetry that they talk about is all the information that's on the race car being beamed back. As we listen to Scott Sharp's radio, that telemetry is... getting all the information coming from the car back to the engineers in the pit box so they can actually hear what's going on.
Firestone telemetry from Scott Sharp's car is working fine. Unfortunately, the car is not. The leaders come flying through on the inside, and Sam Hornish gets the lead on that pass. Sam Hornish takes the lead.
Paul, do you remember I told you that Sam Hornish likes this racetrack? He also likes the high side of the racetrack. On that pass for the lead, it was Sam Hornish throwing a dummy the same way he did at Miami to win the first race and the only race that he's won this year. He went to the inside of Tony Kanaan and got that second place position. I still say he's going to win this race.
And Kanaan pulled up and was able to tack onto the back end of Hornish's car.
Good job working it. Now just keep on working it.
Catherine Evans dropped into third. Weldon fourth. Franchitti is now fifth. Of course, we were riding an onboard at the time that happened. Here's another way to look at it. Or not. We'll try to find the right piece of tape for you. I'm trying to back up a tape to exactly the right point and probably got a little behind it. All right, we'll try and do it again for you. There's Hornish moving to the inside of Kanaan. That grabs second. Oh, yeah. Mansour is running slow high, and I'm not so sure that Sam expected that. Nevertheless, he made it work.
A very aggressive move, especially when it's your teammate and on the front stretch right in front of your boss, guys.
The Toyota, Honda, Toyota top three. The top Chevrolet is Townsend Bell. We've ridden with him quite a bit. And Townsend currently runs in 12. Tony Kanaan is fairly superstitious, Jack.
Oh, he has all sorts of superstitions, but Paul, that special pair of underwear, I hope at least it goes to the laundry in between races.
I don't even want to consider that. Fastest last time around with Brian Herta. Interesting, because there has been some concern being voiced on the radios out of the Rice camp that Herta was keeping Rice from moving forward. You saw that desperate move just a little while ago by Buddy Rice. And there is concern about this guy. Elio Castroneves, after losing the lead, has fallen back to fifth. He's at number three, red and white car, right behind Franchitti.
Now, this is a time in the race when if you've made some changes during your first pit stop, possibly they're not working out for your benefit. So now you go back to your team and tell them you don't like the car. They can see that by that telemetry system. They'll make some more changes on the next pit stop to hopefully improve the car so it handles the same throughout the complete fuel load, which sometimes amounts to 70 laps.
As we showed the moving up and the off the pace, you saw that Manning is one of those that's having some problems. Mile success. Yeah. Andretti Green Racing, they're absolutely dominant on the miles thus far. But Sam Hornish Jr. and Marlboro Team Penske are going to try to make a dent in that record. And as they crossed the start-finish line last time, halfway point, so no rain expected, but it is an official race. Again, Hornish has traffic ahead. A.J. Foyt the fourth and Tori Takagi. He gets Foyt. And that lead is now stretching out for Sam Hornish. He's now 3.6 seconds ahead of that second place car of Tony Kanaan. Can Roger keep him up in the front and take the win? Well, the 100th race in the IRL history has certainly had its moments thus far. On the start, Elio Castroneves moved to the lead, but Thomas Schechter passed five cars in that very first lap. Some tense moments for A.J. Foyt the fourth as the leaders came around. More tense for Mark Taylor, who bounced off of Townsend Bell and into the wall, taking him out of competition. Then on the restart, Townsend Bell trying to move through traffic, used the track plus some. And on the 104th lap, Matsura slowing in front of the leaders, and that gave the opportunity to Sam Hornish Jr. And he took the lead. He stayed there ever since. In fact, he's been pulling away now a little over 5 seconds ahead of second place Tony Kanaan. Dan Weldon now sits in third. Don't forget, tonight the Little League World Series is on the line as the U.S. champions California, boy, last night behind Cody Thompson's great pitching, took the win over Texas. And tonight they take on international powerhouse, the Nether Antilles, in the championship game. 6:30 in the East, 3:30 Pacific, right here on ABC Sports Championship Television. On board fourth place, Dario Franchitti. Two victories points-wise, kind of balanced out by those performances where he's well back in the field.
Watch as he drives. You can see his right hand there going to the gear shifter, but also reaching across, doing some internal adjustments on the roll bars, telling you he's probably not very happy with the car. Those roll bars adjust the suspension front and rear, and he made some adjustments that last lap. As he gets through two, off the gas a fair amount, now he goes down to that run, down to three.
His wife, Ashley Judd, watches from the back of the scoring stand. Toyota, Honda, 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 and then Toyota in sixth after Nevison. There are 64 laps, including some caution laps, 10 of them, since their last stop. And so probably the next 7 or 8 laps, you would think they'll be back in the pits again. On board Tony Kanaan, 6 seconds ahead of this car is Sam Hornish Jr.
Well, I have a newfound respect for these drivers as far as touring around this racetrack and having to shift as many times as they do as well. It's hard. It looks so easy when they do it. Last night I ran a mini sprint where I had to shift 4 or 5 times a lap on a 7th mile. I couldn't get it right any time. So all of a sudden, these guys truly are the best at it.
Townsend Bell in routine service for him. Hey, Scott Goodyear, you owe me the $5. I bet you that Jack would bring that up. Let's go down to Jerry Punch.
And Kosuke Matsura has stepped out of the Panasonic car. Kosuke, what happened?
My car was in a weird loose at the turn two. I had to break turn one as well. And my right front brake was temperature too high. And brake was fired.
A very tough place to drive with no brakes, Scott Goodyear.
Well, you see that brake and the heat coming off it right there. When the car's not working and you're off the pace like Kotsky was, you're on the brakes a fair amount of time and probably just overheated the brake, I would suspect.
Yeah, Kotsky Matsura had 700 dealers from Panasonic and consumers out to watch the race this weekend, so I'm sure he would have liked to perform better. He is only one of 2 cars that are out of the race, the other, of course, being Taylor. When Taylor got into the wall after bouncing off of Townsend Bell. Let's take it back a few laps.
Now watch the 3 car, Elio Castroneves on the inside, that red and white car, going underneath the 52 of Ed Carpenter, just on the curbing and then just touching the right front wheel to Carpenter's left front, a small amount. Very aggressive move, but you gotta get through the traffic if you can and when you can, Paul.
Carpenter has been struggling with the handling on that car. Currently running 7 laps behind the race itself and averaging about 139 miles an hour each time around. There's Buddy Rice, currently in 8th place in his Pioneer car. And he's got to sit there just knowing full well that he's losing points. What he really needs is a championship to match his Indianapolis 500 victory. But sitting where he is with his teammate Vitor Mira just ahead of him is not the place he'd like to be.
A lot of people think that Buddy Rice is just a slice out of the X Games, but there's more to Buddy Rice than that. He has a great engineering mind, Paul. In some conversation I had with him, he expounded on shock technology, and he's really working hard on that. And every team that he goes with, that's one of the extra things he brings to the table. He likes to deal with a lot of the mechanical aspects of the race car and its engineering.
And you'd think that shock work for the Indy 500 champion would come in large part due to the fact he is a great fan of motorcycle racing. Of course, shocks is everything there right now. He's got his finger on that pulse, and he can bring it over to the four-wheeler. Thomas Schechter comes onto the pit road on the 138th lap. And it's now, for most of the field, 74 laps since their last stop. So you would expect the leaders in shortly as well.
You may wonder how the fueler knows when to disconnect. Not only does the crew chief have it, but inside each of the fueler's helmets is a red and a green light. When it's time to disconnect, the light goes from red to green.
Nice little stop there for the Pennzoil Panther team. Notice they're being more and more deliberate with the disconnects.
You saw that very narrow pit exit lane, very bumpy here at this race course. And on cold tires, guys, I can tell you from experience, very difficult to navigate.
Jerry Punch, Kanaan is in second, still without telemetry.
Exactly, Paul. For the fans who are just joining our coverage, they have no way of monitoring his fuel consumption here in the pits. And as you see Kim Green here, who runs the pits for Tony Kanaan, Kim is relying on information from Kyle Moyer in the pits adjacent to them for Dario Franchitti. Now, Franchitti can go to lap 154, but Kim Green says, as the points leader, we cannot take a chance and possibly run out of fuel with the points lead. So they're going to come in around 150 to 151. No telemetry. They cannot afford to guess.
Tony Kanaan has had an envious record leading or driving every lap that could be raced this season as we take a look at Vitor Mira in the 17 car. And he's led almost a third of those laps this season. But, of course, that just says to you, is he due? Is there something that is either going to go wrong with the car or a mistake to be made by Tony that could have a massive impact upon the championship fight?
Vitor Mira had never seen Nazareth Speedway until he got off an airplane and came here on Thursday. The first tour that he got was in a car, a passenger car. And I said, well, what did you learn about the racetrack? Well, I knew where it was.
He could get to it. Caution comes out. Car against the wall, and that's Carpenter. Oh, he'd been struggling all day with that car and finally lost the struggle. And that's right on the entrance to the pit road, too.
Paul, you mentioned the speed that he was doing, 139, 138 miles an hour. That's sometimes about 15 to 18 miles an hour as we look at his team owner, Eddie Cheever, with the Red Bull team. A lot of disappointing weekends here for this team so far this year, and this is just one of them. A lot of damage they've done so far, and this is the second car they've crashed so far this weekend.
Well, Ed Carpenter was trying to gut it out with a car that had been reported as being in fairly bad handling shape early on, falling the eight laps behind, and the last car of all of those running right now. I'm surprised they kept it out.
Well, it's a difficult call to make. You want to stay out there and give him experience because it's sort of new to him. Not a whole lot of open wheel experience with the Indy cars, but the longer you stay out, the more experience you gain. But if you're actually going that slow, sometimes you're in the way and you start driving from your mirrors a little bit instead of looking forward, and sooner or later it catches you out.
So Red Bull Team Cheever has one of his cars out of competition. Alex Baron is still out there and running in 12th place.
And as we saw there, when he was coming off of two, he was up in the gray area, as we call it, off the black area where all the traction is, where you end up getting it. And here we're going to look just ahead of him. You can see the car already grazing the wall up there. Thomas Schechter obviously has to take some avoidant mission there, make sure that he misses all the parts on the racetrack that are coming off the car. There's debris going through there. Guys, I've had that before, and I can tell you when it comes at you at about 150 miles an hour, you have to duck.
Yeah, you may think that it looks light when that debris comes at you, but it could be quite heavy. Here is Ed Carpenter yesterday.
You know, so the back end come around there very quickly. Talked to him, he said, you know, this was just on cold tires here. Trying to do a simulated qualifying run. You can see the displeasure right now with Eddie Cheever, wants to run down just to make sure that he was all right.
Yeah, Eddie took right off to head down to that car yesterday. So Eddie's got some repair work to do back in their Indianapolis, Indiana shop up on the northwest side of town as it goes on the hook. And very shortly, the pit should open for the second, certainly not the last stop, though it's going to be fairly close depending on cautions.
Well, Paul, if they get in there in lap 150 and end up getting out there, that's 75 laps to go. It's a possibility.
Depends on the length of this caution period. Todd Harris.
Well, Sam Hornish is first in as your leader. They told me moments ago it's going to be fuel tires and a half turn on that front wing. And if you remember last week, Dr. Jerry Scott reported that Ryan Penske was half the way through. And even if Smiley got a fuel problem.
We've got another pit problem. And fuel burn out.
She got a man on fire. You can see.
We got flames in the pits, guys. We got flames in the pits. Everyone's going for one.
They're still trying to get that fire out. They pour water on them. Water will dilute the methanol fuel, and that will put the fire out.
Yeah, still got fires, though. A little bit of fire.
You okay, Todd?
Yeah, I did a Dan Marinelli-like last time. I got fuel on me because he pulled away. They thought they had it out, and then he pulled again. It ripped the hose, and a massive amount of methanol came out. One man hit the deck. He immediately ignited, and you could feel the flames down here. You could just feel the heat burning, and all of us We all went running, and everyone does a great job down here just grabbing buckets and dumping it on each other. But I think so far, looks like everyone's going to be okay.
Of course, the dead man valve is up at the tank itself, and that lets go immediately, but there's still the length of the hose. And there's a fire on the car still. It's on the left side of the car.
Yeah, you can see the fire right there coming out there. Remember, that's where the fuel, and that Buckeye is probably still open. Some of the fuel is probably still exiting out of the car right now. The radio would have been able to tell him that he's on fire, come on in. What he also can do, guys, is stop beside.
On the radio, I'm coming into pit lane, we got a fire.
He can also stop on the racetrack in one of the fire stations, of which there is four around this racetrack.
Well, if that valve is stuck open.
What they don't want him, though, is they do not want him down the pit lane. They want him away from the fuel tankers.
Yeah, he's got full flames on the left side of that car. It's just coming out, and it's exactly where the fuel goes in, so they're absolutely dousing him. The situation, though, is, guys, they had to stop him about 15 feet short of where he is because there's still fuel. And although it's been diluted, they don't want to run any chances of him re-sparking it.
And that's part of the point, is that if that valve at the top of the fuel tank is open in any way, then it might refeed the fuel. And look at how they get a crank on that fuel refiller, and that could damage that whole valving system. Oh my goodness.
Now there's a major issue coming on ever since the Michigan race. If you can recall, there was quite a few pit instances there. As we watch this again, you end up seeing the car try to leave with the fuel Buckeye in, and this is when the problems happen. Guys, there has been many fines levied by Brian Barnhart, the vice president of operations from the IRL with these teams. He told these guys in the driver's meeting this morning, you guys have to take time, you have to slow down. No accidents are expected here today. You guys can do this correctly.
The first bucket of water came over the wall from Roger Penske himself, who got right into fighting the fire, Todd.
Well, here's the hose, guys, and you can see the force. This thing is extremely thick. It's okay to handle it now because it's been soaked. We've all been soaked with water for safety reasons, but here it is. The hose was in, it was connected, and like we've seen in the last few races, he started pulling away, and that puts torque on this, unable to get away from it, and I don't know if he didn't get the full stop sign or what, but he went away, and it just shredded the hose, and the fuel just poured out, and I bet we lost a good 15 to 20 gallons, and that's what ignited.
Now Roger Penske looks over the situation that has taken his car from the lead down to 12th place. Now exiting the pits, look what happens here. That's Danny Weldon coming out in the lead ahead of Tony Kanaan, and the other Andretti green car, Dario Franchitti, will come into view in just a second because he came out in third place. Their fourth car, Brian Herta, currently sits in seventh. There's Franchitti. Then in the actual lineup, Fernandez, and then the other Penske car, Elio Castroneves. So that gives Dan Weldon the lead. Another update on the situation down there in the Penske pits.
All right, Paul, the situation is when Sam came in and they dumped those buckets of water on him, they got the fire put out. They asked him, are you okay? He said, yes, but when you dumped all that water on me, I've lost my dash. So he's fighting a bunch of battles down here, Paul.
So we've got two cars without good telemetry or at least good information. Tony Kanaan and now Sam Hornish Jr. as they try to clean up the track with Dan Weldon in front. Caution in the Firestone Indy 225 at Nazareth Speedway, the 100th race in the IRL IndyCar Series history. The caution started out with a wall impact, extended when Sam Hornish Jr., as we show you the top 10 currently running, Sam Hornish Jr. had problem on a pit stop and a refuel, and now Hornish has dropped to the last car on the lead lap. In 12th place, we're going to show it to you again. It happened in Roger Penske's pit. Scott?
Always a dangerous time during pit stops to see the tires are finished. Right now, the fueler is still in. Now, Roger Penske or whoever on the team is telling them via radio, go, 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 or Sam misheard it. I'm not a fan of the radio system because anything can go wrong, and we see this here. If you have a right front man holding you back before he lets you take off, then he gets a chance to look over the car and make sure everything is done. The tires are done, the fuel's pulled out, and then he can release you. Different systems are done by different teams, but I have to tell you, I'm a fan of having the right front man stand in front of the car and then watch everybody overseeing. Now you can see the man running on the ground. Roger Penske gets the water, douses the drivers, or the crewman rather. And as a driver, I will tell you, you feel real bad because you don't know what's going on in the pit lane right now and you're driving out in the racetrack. And then we saw Sam Hornish's car having a fire on it.
Keep in mind, fellas, that Roger Penske doesn't wear Nomex. He's in a short sleeve shirt and still went after that to try and save his crewman.
So can they get their guy, Elio Castroneves, up to the front? Or even Hornish Jr.? We'll be back after this message and a word from our ABC station. Of a second, that finish will be there in 2 weeks for the Delphi Indy 300 at Chicagoland Speedway. Ready to go back to green flag. Dan Weldon out in front. We ride with Tony Kanaan in second place. Andretti green cars are first through third. Weldon, Kanaan, Franchitti. Trying to make moves early. They will give Sam Hornish Jr. a drive-through penalty because of the problems on his stop. And that'll take him off of the lead lap. Despite all that trouble, he was able to stay there. Well, with Weldon leading and Rice in sixth place, Weldon moves around Rice and into second in the points fight, behind his teammate, Tony Kanaan.
Danny Weldon's car right now is looking pretty stout. He's actually gaining a lot of time over his teammate, Kanaan, going through turn two.
There's Sam Hornish Jr. He is answering.
Coming through the start finish, you're okay.
Answering the black flag with a drive-through penalty and hoping to stay ahead of the leader. Roger Penske told him he'd be fine on the radio. Castroneves works Fernandez. That's Buddy Rice, the 15 car, right behind Castroneves.
It looked like Buddy Rice.
Yellow again. And this time it's a debris caution. Whoa.
As soon as the yellow's out, there's no passing. Maybe Buddy didn't see the yellow, but his Pioneer Archer car certainly was loose coming off of turn three that last time, trying to put the power down.
But guys, it clearly illustrates the feeling that Buddy Rice must have in the cockpit right now of urgency, because I'm sure he's figured it out as well that Weldon has moved into second place in the points.
Back, take a look at that one again.
See, he's actually stuck up the rear tailpipe right there of Castroneves. Probably did not see the flag stand and did not notice the lights on his dash that the yellow was out.
They do have three different ways to know that there is a yellow. Minimally, lights around the track, lights on the dashboard of the car, the radio call, yellow, 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 and of course a flag at the start finish line. And Roger Penske get back in this game? We'll find out. Michael Andretti's moved down to Danny Weldon's pits. His car is currently run first, second, third, and seventh. We're ready to go back to green flag racing. 170th lap. Dan Weldon at front.
Green, green, green.
They answer the green. It bottles up behind him. Franchitti's clear. Catherine Nevis trying to catch Franchitti, and Buddy Rice doing everything he can to get another position. There's Adrian Fernandez.
Big problem on the start for Adrian Fernandez. He dropped down into the bottom part of the 10th in the top 10, into seventh position after running fifth. Didn't look like he came up through the gearbox as quickly as everybody else.
Now that yellow guy's helped one guy, Sam Hornish Jr., because remember, with that drive-through penalty, he was about ready to be lapped by Danny Weldon, because he could see him in his mirrors, but that penalty allowed him to come back to the tail end of the lead lap.
Looking back from Darren Manning's car to Fernandez. This is on the restart, and there you see Fernandez. They all get bottled up behind him. Buddy Rice is able to get around Elio Castroneves and slide into fourth place behind Dario Franchitti. Jerry Punch, something new on Fernandez?
Well, I guess what happened, Paul, there was a bit of a miscommunication on the restart. I just talked with John Ward. He said apparently the spotter didn't think they were going to go green and didn't give Adrian the go-ahead for the green flag, and that cost him some valuable time on the restart. No gear problem, simply a miscommunication from spotter to driver.
Yeah, but you know what? They do flash the yellow onboard lights. The officials do to tell them that they're going to go back to green after any given caution period. And sooner or later, you do kind of have to turn responsibility to the guy in the cockpit, eh, Scott?
Well, there's certainly the lights right there have the opportunity to be turned out when they're about ready to go green. But sometimes you certainly do have one or two laps that you have to wait for that, Paul.
Target fastest lap of the race as we watch Dan Weldon. Goes to Dan Weldon, 156.8 miles an hour. In the scheme of things, it doesn't sound all that fast, but let me assure you, on this mile, it is very fast. Going back and looking for Buddy Rice now. There he is. Currently fourth behind Franchitti and unchallenged by Catherine Evans at the moment.
Well, this race has started to play into what he thought might work this morning when I spoke to him, where he thought maybe the track and the race might come to him, and he's sitting in fourth right now. I asked him about his time off next week, and he goes, no time off. He says, I'm going off to go testing for a couple of days, flying to Ohio for a team member's wedding. And he says, I'll get Sunday off, and then we're back on to Chicago.
This fall, the benefactor is looking for the contestant with billionaire qualities. And the game starts the minute they walk through the door. Who will pass his test for success? The benefactor premieres Monday, September 13th, only on ABC. Well, there's Franchitti and a very hungry Buddy Rice, who needs points and needs them badly, and not being helped by the fact that his closest competitor in the points battle, Dan Weldon, is leading this race.
Well, he's not going to get any help from any of those three guys in front of him, Paul, because if Rice is to go past Franchitti, Franchitti knows that's points for him in the championship for his teammate Tony Kanaan running just ahead of him. He'll be maybe making the car as wide as possible.
Good move putting Winona on that list, didn't it? Don't want your sister-in-law coming in.
I was
going to
say, it keeps peace and harmony in the family, I would imagine.
Exactly. She's on my list, though. And, Scott, you're a country music fan, aren't you?
Like all type of country music, some strong Canadian country performers, I might add.
And caution once again. Oh, and this involves some pretty serious contact. Scott Sharp. Come sliding right up to the camera in the Delphi car. You saw him had his hands off the wheel.
Where was he, 40? He wasn't up on me, was he?
No, I knew he was going to throw it in there in the last minute, dude. No, he just ran out of patience, man.
That sharp radio to his spotter, and he said he wasn't up beside me, was he? And he said, no, it looks like he just drove it in there hard and threw it in there.
Of course, he is Townsend Bell in the two car, parked against the wall just behind him. Townsend has been particularly aggressive today. So our fourth caution, as they're running down pretty close to the end of the race, and Scott Sharp props himself up in the car. They want to make sure he's okay before they tell him to get all the way out.
And we talked about that yellow light the drivers see. There it is right there inside the cockpit that's always flashing.
Let's go to Todd Harris.
All right, thank you, Paul. First of all, Roger, is everyone okay?
Everybody's fine. Yeah, we were lucky. Just one of those things. Everybody's pretty anxious to get away. And fortunately, had a little bit of a fire here. They gave us a drive-through, and we're back running again. But disappointing.
An auspicious day for you. Talk about Elio Castroneves and Sam, how they're running right now with the laps that we have left.
Well, I think right now, you know, we're okay. We ran 21.5, pretty good lap here just a little bit ago. We got a lot of work to do to get to the front, and both cars do, but we still got plenty of laps to go.
Wish you luck. Be safe.
Thanks.
Paul.
Oh, Roger Penske still trying to get one of his cars up as far as he can. Hornish would have a massive task to get from 12th up to the front, but Castroneves is in fifth. Here is that situation.
You can see the contact has already happened, possibly Bell trying to go underneath Sharp going into the turn, and had already had Sharp turned around sideways. Now as we watch Bell, gonna peek inside, going into three where everybody likes to pass, just not up beside Sharp far enough. That right front ends up getting Sharp's left rear. A lot of damage there. There he goes, getting the draft up from Sharp's car. Goes in front. And you can see Sharp's off the gas because he doesn't have great handling, possibly. Very slippery turn down there in three.
Yeah, Sharp is upset. Dr. Henry Bach tries to pull him back. But Sharp, I would think, has a right to be upset. I mean, the obligation's still with the guy that's doing the passing.
Well, they always say spotters can let you know where the cars are around you. Spotters do not drive the car, so these two guys will end up having some conversation about this once they both get out of the car. But you would probably want to see Townsend Bell just a little bit further along the Delphi car, Scott Sharp, and then he will be saying, boy, I sure wanted some more space from Scott Sharp, and he should have given me some more room. His spotter should have let him know I was there. So that's going to be a great conversation I'd like to listen into.
Hey, Jerry Punch, it's Andretti Green Racing, 1-2-3, and Michael Andretti's hometown.
And Paul, how about that? What a way to say goodbye to his home racetrack here in Nazareth. If he could get a 1-2-3 hat trick here in the final race at Nazareth. And I talked to Michael a moment ago, and what he and Tony Kottman did here in Dan Weldon's pit was go down and talk to Kim Green and Tony Kanaan's guys. And they've had a team meeting early in the week, so if it comes down to us and you, remember, we have to think about the big picture. We're not gonna take a win away from Weldon or Kanaan. You guys battle it on the racetrack, but be smart and consider each other, and particularly in traffic, remember the big picture, the points in the championship plus the wins, it's in that order.
Well, Jerry, you may wonder, you know, Tony Kanaan was in this position, as I said, 1 year ago, and it went away, and Scott Dixon won the race. There's a big difference in Tony Kanaan this time around, and we sat in and talked to Tony at length, and we'll be bringing you that a little bit later in the chase for the championship and some of the future events starting at Chicago and California. But he said there's a major difference in the way I approach racing now. He said, I'm married. He said, I go home, and my wife will say to me, look, if you've had a bad day, forget about it. He said, when I was single, I didn't have that input.
Mm-hmm. Don't forget, you will be able to chat with the winner of this race, whomever it may be, and it's clearly not nearly decided at this point. Just log on to ESPN.com, search the IRL, and chat with the winner of the Firestone Indy 225, the last race here at Nazareth and the 100th in the IRL history. It looks like it's going to be a great matchup tonight. Both teams 5-0 at 6:30 on ABC Sports, 3:30 Pacific. Now, Scott Goodyear, you can talk to this man.